Hi, I'm Jason with Kimray, and today we're going to be repairing the gas-operated back pressure valve. I'm going to get my safety glasses on and get started. Before you do any disassembly, you'll want to take a Sharpie or a paint pen and make a mark on every layer of the valve. That way, when you reassemble it, you'll be able to line everything up correctly. You'll want to start by removing your adjustment screw and keeping your four upper bolts intact while you remove your tubing so that it keeps the upper housing steady. Once you remove your gauge, you can take your four main bolts out of the upper bonnet. Next, you'll want to rotate the pilot housing to remove your tubing. Remove your upper bonnet, upper spring plate, spring, and lower spring plate, and your crush ring. When you're removing your pilot housing, a lot of times they get stuck from rust and corrosion out in the field, so you may have to take a flathead screwdriver and wedge it in between the pilot housing and upper housing to break that apart. Once you remove your pilot housing, you'll want to remove your upper pilot seat. You'll just hold the diaphragm plate in the palm of your hand and use a 9/16 wrench to loosen the upper seat. Next, you'll use a 9/16 socket to remove the lower seat. Before you remove your upper housing, you'll want to take out your breather plugs. Now you can remove all of your upper housing bolts. After you remove your upper housing bolts, you may have to use a flathead screwdriver to pry the upper housing away from the lower housing breather plug communication port. Once you remove your upper housing and your main diaphragm, you'll want to use a flathead screwdriver and wedge it between the lower housing and the body to pry it loose. Your lower housing should have oil that you need to dump out. After you remove your lower housing, you should be able to see your removable seat in the body. At this point, you'll want to inspect your removable seat surface to make sure there's no corrosion, pitting, or scoring. Also check your gasket to make sure it's not torn. If it looks good, go ahead and leave it in the body. It's not worth it to try to remove the seat. You might end up doing more damage to it. If you do find significant corrosion or wear on your seat surface, you'll want to use your Kimray removable seat tool to get the seat out of the body. This valve's removable seat looks pretty good, but here's an example of one that definitely needs to be replaced. This corrosion and pitting would keep the elastomer seat from sealing against the removable seat. Next, you'll want to put your lower housing into your vise to be able to disassemble it. The easiest way to do this is to take the diaphragm plate and put it into your vise. To remove your ratio plug, your seat, and your seat disc, you'll have to loosen this lock nut. The lock nut doesn't always come loose. Sometimes your main stem starts to unthread from your diaphragm plate. You may have to get some soft jaws to clamp down on this main stem in your vise to keep it from moving. Next, you'll want to remove your two Teflon backups and your O-ring from your lower housing. Then you'll remove the main gasket from the lower housing. Next, you'll want to remove your filter body and filter body nipple from your pilot housing. Now you'll put your filter housing into the vise and remove your filter screens. You can use a small flathead screwdriver and stick it through the gauge hole to be able to push those screens out. Once you have the screens in position, you can use needle nose pliers or a flathead screwdriver to pull the screens out. To disassemble the diaphragm plate assembly, you'll want to put the diaphragm plate in a vise and use a pair of channel locks to loosen the diaphragm nut. Now that your valve is fully disassembled, now's a good time to open your Kimray Repair Kit, organize all the parts before reassembling. Now you should be ready for reassembly. If you ever get confused about where a part should go, each Kimray Repair Kit should come with a cut sheet designating part number and part location. Next, you'll want to inspect your body for any rust or debris that might clog your filter body later whenever you put the valve into service. Next, you'll want to use compressed air to make sure that your sense line communication port isn't clogged. You might have to use a putty knife or some emery cloth to clean the gasket surface on top of the body. Next, you'll replace your gasket on your removable seat and install the removable seat into the body. Any gasket that you put back into the valve assembly will need to be lubricated with any kind of multi-purpose grease. Now you're ready to reassemble your lower housing. Start by making sure that your breather plug communication port is clear of any debris. Then lubricate the gasket surface with multi-purpose grease. Place the gasket on the lower housing and grease the top side of the gasket as well. Now you're ready to reinstall your Teflon backups an O-ring into the lower housing. For this part, you'll need an awl or a small flathead screwdriver. And you'll just take this Teflon back up and just stretch it out slightly to where it looks like a spring. You'll insert one end of the Teflon back up into the lower housing and then use your awl or your flathead screwdriver and rotate it in a counterclockwise motion until the Teflon backup is fully installed. When you're installing your O-ring, you'll want to pinch and fold it until it looks like this. This will make it a lot easier to install it in the lower housing. Go ahead and push your O-ring and your first Teflon backup all the way down to the bottom of that lower housing channel to make room for the last Teflon backup. Again, you'll just stretch it out until it looks like a spring. Insert one end of the Teflon backup into the lower housing, and then rotate your screwdriver or your awl in a counterclockwise motion around the rim. Be sure to lubricate your Teflon backups and your O-ring before installing your lower stem and diaphragm plate. When you're installing the lower stem into the lower housing, it's a good idea to use a Kimray stem guide to avoid shearing your O-ring. Next, you'll want to put your lower housing into a vise and clamp down on the diaphragm plate to keep everything still while you're installing your ratio plug and your seat disc. Next, you can install your seat disc, seat, and ratio plug. When tightening this lock nut, it's critical not to over-tighten it and deform the seat. You want to tighten it down to the point where the seat disc doesn't rotate. Now you can install your lower housing into your body. Before you install your lower housing, you want to make sure that the lower stem moves freely. As you're reassembling the valve, be sure to align all of the marks that we made before we disassembled. Now you'll want to fill your lower housing with any kind of light gravity motor oil to keep the lower stem lubricated. Be sure to fill the lower housing to the point where the communication hole to the lower stem is fully submerged. Now you can start cleaning your upper housing. You'll want to make sure that your gasket seating area on the lower seat is clear of any debris. You may have to take some emery cloth or a flathead screwdriver and scrape out the old gasket. You can insert a small screwdriver or an awl into the breather plug communication port until you can see it down inside of the upper housing. This will ensure that there's nothing obstructing this pathway. Also check the port going to the diaphragm for any obstructions. Now you can install your main diaphragm and mount your upper housing onto the body. Be sure to hand start all your bolts. Tighten down two opposite bolts evenly and then alternate it in a star pattern, just like you would the lug nuts on a wheel. Next, you can install the lower seat into the upper housing. You'll start by putting this small gasket around the seat, hand starting the threads, and you just want this to be snug to avoid tearing through that gasket. Never use any grease or oil in the pilot plug area. Any debris could keep the pilot plug from seating correctly. Next, we'll install the filter body back onto the pilot housing. Before you reinstall your filter body, you'll want to spray some compressed air through the tubing elbow and the connection nipple to make sure it's free from any obstruction. Next, you'll want to install your filter screens into your filter body. These filter screens are made out of a sheet of mesh, and they punch them with a punch press. And that causes the edge of these little screens to be rolled in a certain direction. Whenever you're installing them into the filter body, you want to make sure that that rolled side is facing up. It's a lot easier to do them one at a time. The filter body has a lip down inside that the screens will rest against, so just push them down until you feel that mechanical stop. Once you've installed your filter screens, you'll want to replace the O-ring on your filter body cap and reinstall it. When you're tightening the filter body plug, just get it snug so you don't break the connection nipple. Next, we'll put together our upper diaphragm assembly. Put the upper diaphragm plate into the vise. Put your upper diaphragm onto the diaphragm plate. And then snug your diaphragm nut on top of the upper diaphragm. Be sure that you don't over-tighten the diaphragm nut and deform the diaphragm. Just get it snug. Next, you can install your cone-shaped spring, small side up, inside of your upper diaphragm plate. Then you can install your upper diaphragm onto your upper seat. Next, you're going to take your pilot housing and your upper seat. Set your pilot housing on top of your upper diaphragm plate. Then take your upper seat with pilot plug installed and thread it into your upper diaphragm plate. This just needs to be snug. If you've done everything correctly, you should feel the resistance of the spring as you push the pilot plug down. Next, you'll mount the pilot housing assembly onto the upper housing. As you mount the pilot housing assembly to the upper housing, make sure that your pilot plug and your pilot diaphragm are both centered. Install your crush ring around your upper diaphragm plate. Be sure to put a dab of grease on your upper diaphragm plate, underneath your lower spring plate. Install your spring and upper spring plate, and put a dab of grease on top of your upper spring plate. Now you can install your bonnet. Before we tighten these bolts all the way down, we're going to install our tubing. Now you can tighten down your bonnet bolts. Once your bonnet bolts are tight, you can tighten your tubing fittings. Make sure that there's nothing clogging your breather plugs and install them in the upper and lower housings. Be sure to tighten the breather plugs in such a way that the breather hole isn't pointing up, but pointing down or at an angle. This makes it harder for rain and debris to get inside and clog the breather plug. Now you can reinstall your gauge. That concludes the repair. If you have any questions about the Kimray tools that I use today, reach out to your local representative or visit us at kimray.com.